In this short video tutorial, we're going to consider the organisation of the structures within the neck. Now, the neck acts as a conduit or passageway for quite a number of structures that are running between the head and the thorax. This, of course, includes structures like blood vessels, or arteries and veins, nerves, but also important elements of the respiratory and the gastrointestinal system, like the larynx and the trachea and the pharynx and oesophagus. Now, the arrangement of these structures within the neck are perhaps most easily considered by looking at the neck in cross-section, as this really helps us to appreciate the anatomical arrangement and the relationships of the different structures. Now, very similarly to in the upper limb and the lower limb, the structures that are running through the neck are compartmentalised by a series of concentrically arranged fibrous sheets of tissue called fascia. Now, these fibrous sheets of tissue, for the most part, run the length of the neck from the base of the skull, either down onto the chest wall or even into the thorax. Now, because this fascia is within the neck, it's called cervical fascia. And there is a number of layers, although we can broadly categorise them as either being superficial cervical fascia or deep cervical fascia. The superficial cervical fascial layer, of which there's only one, lies immediately below the skin. It consists of very loose connective tissue with fat, superficial lymph nodes and superficial blood vessels like the external jugular vein, and also some cutaneous nerves that are supplying the skin of the neck. We also find the platysma muscle within this superficial cervical layer. And that muscle, as we know, arises from the lower part of the face, the inferior border of the mandible, and descends down the neck, blending onto the sort of clavicle, sternum and anterior chest wall. There are four deep cervical fascial layers, and these are obviously, as the name suggests, deeper within the neck than the superficial cervical layer. And these four are given different names depending on the structures that they enclose. And they're much more dense in terms of the arrangement of the connective tissue and much tougher than the fascial layer that we see most superficially. So let's begin by then having a look at the structures of the neck. If we take this image here, which has removed the skin and the superficial cervical fascial layer, we're looking here directly onto the first of the deep fascial layers in the neck. This is called the investing layer. Now, if we take a cross-section through the neck at this sort of level and look at that in cross-section, so I'll just draw essentially this first layer of deep cervical fascia, which is called the investing layer, and we'll label at the top anteriorly, so this would be the front of the neck, and obviously at the back, posterior, the back of the neck. So this is looking at the neck in cross-section as if we were looking from the feet up towards the head, which is how we would view CT images. So the deep cervical fascial layers, which we'll consider first, as we know there's four of those, and the first being the investing layer, which I've just drawn in red. So we have a number of other deep cervical layers, which we'll start to add into the picture. So what sort of things have we got running through the neck? Well, most anteriorly, certainly at this level, we have the thyroid gland. Now, if you remember, the thyroid gland, if we were looking at it directly front on, is H-shaped. So it has a central isthmus here and two lateral lobes either side. Now, because at the cervical vertebral level we've taken this cross-section, we've cut right through the thyroid gland at the level of the isthmus. So there's the isthmus and these are the two lateral lobes. Now, immediately behind that, we find the trachea, which is a continuation, obviously, of the larynx from C6 onwards. And behind that, the oesophagus, which is a continuation of the pharynx at the vertebral level of C6 as well. And coming towards the back of the neck, we have a very a bony muscular area, which consists of the cervical vertebrae, which I'm just drawing here, which are surrounded by a number of muscles, many of which run the entire length of the neck and the spine. And collectively, these are called the pre- and paravertebral muscles, which I'll just draw on here. So these don't necessarily represent the exact number of these muscles. It's just to indicate that there's quite a few here surrounding the vertebrae. and they're obviously helping to anchor the head to the neck and onto the rest of the body. Now, between these two, we have a number of neurovascular structures that are running up and down the neck between the thorax and the head, and these are within their own fascial compartment known as the carotid sheath. So the carotid sheath there is the green circles, and within these are the neurovascular structures that are running up and down the neck. So at this level, it would include the common carotid artery. Had we taken the section slightly higher up the neck, then we may have involved the internal carotid artery as the common carotid artery, which I'm just drawing here in the sort of slightly lighter red dot, would have split into its two terminal branches. We also find within the carotid sheath the internal jugular vein, which lies more laterally within the carotid sheath, so more laterally in the neck. And behind that, which I'm just drawing in yellow, is the vagus nerve. So the vagus nerve will arise from the brainstem, enter through the base of the skull and run down the length of the neck into the thorax. So within the carotid sheath, as I said, we've got the common carotid artery at this level. Higher up in the neck, when the common carotid artery bifurcates, the external carotid artery would leave the carotid sheath, whereas the internal will continue right the way up to the base of the skull through which it enters intracranially. And we also have the internal jugular vein and the vagus. So IJV and the two vagus nerves on either side. Now the structures at the back here, the muscles and the bones, and the visceral structures at the front here, the thyroid gland, trachea and oesophagus, also have their own fascial compartments. So if we draw those on next, starting with thinking around the structures at the back, there is a layer of fascia that runs right the way from the base of the skull right the way down the neck, so a column of fascia completely enclosing the vertebrae and the muscles of the neck, extending down into the thorax and usually blend with the vertebrae at about T3, and this is the prevertebral cervical fascia. So moving on then, more anteriorly, we come to our what we can collectively call visceral structures, thyroid gland, trachea and oesophagus. But just in front of that, we have a number of strap-like muscles, which I'm just drawing here, called the infrahyoid muscles. And there's four of these, and they all arise from the hyoid bone and run down the neck, lying immediately in front of the thyroid gland. So these muscles are just important to note at this point because they're also encased or enveloped by a fascial layer here, which I'm drawing in blue. So along with the visceral structures, trachea and thyroid and oesophagus, the infrahyoid muscles are also compartmentalised within the pretracheal fascia. So the infrahyoid muscles are within the muscular layer of the pretracheal fascia, and the structures just behind that, these are what we call the visceral layer of the pretracheal fascia. So collectively it's still a compartment that has subcompartments in, as it were, but it's still collectively known as pretracheal fascia. So that's the one in slightly lighter blue. So there we have the fourth of our four deep cervical fascial layers. Now, depending on where you read, the carotid sheath is possibly considered to actually take its sort of origins from the other three cervical fascial layers. It's not perhaps as easily seen in the diagram. Now, there's a bit of the pretracheal fascia here that I just want to highlight to you. Now, this is the posterior wall of the pretracheal fascia, which runs directly behind the pharynx and the oesophagus. And even though it's still part of the pretracheal fascia, it's also known as the buccopharyngeal fascia. Now this extends from the base of the skull right the way down into the thorax, blending with the pericardial sac, running behind the oesophagus and obviously higher up the neck, the pharynx. The pretracheal fascia anteriorly, however, here, does inferiorly blend with the pericardial sac too, but as its origin is from the hyoid bone, we don't find this bit of the pretracheal fascia higher up in the neck. So, there we've introduced the four deep cervical fascial layers and the structures that are running through them. And there's a few more things that we just need to add to this picture before we complete what we see in cross-section at the level of the neck here. So there is a couple of muscles in the neck that you'll have learnt about called sternocleidomastoid, which I'll draw on here, which is a long strap-like muscle which runs from the mastoid process down onto the sternum and the clavicle. You can see it here laterally. And posteriorly in the neck, we have this broad triangular muscle called trapezius, which arises again from the base of the skull round onto the spine of the scapula and the clavicle. So if we add these to the diagram, we need to think about first perhaps just adding the skin, which we'll draw in black. So that's the skin of the neck. And the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscles don't lie immediately below the skin. So they're not in the superficial cervical fascia. They're actually, if I draw them on here, they're actually surrounded by the investing layer of deep cervical fascia. And that's because it splits to completely encase these muscles so that they have their own compartments, essentially. Draw them on like that. Okay, so then that leaves our final layer of cervical fascia, the superficial cervical fascia, which we know lies immediately below the skin. So within there we'd have in the superficial cervical fascia, as we said, some superficial lymph nodes, some veins like the external jugular vein, cutaneous nerves supplying the neck of the skin. And we also have a muscle which runs right the way down the front of the neck like a sheet, which is the platysma muscle. So if you remember, the platysma muscle arises from the lower part of the jaw, the inferior border of the mandible, and extends right the way down the front of the anterolateral neck onto the clavicle and chest wall. And we know it's a very, very superficial muscle, and it lies just beneath the skin, but within the superficial cervical fascial layer. So we'll draw the platysma on there to essentially complete the sort of key structures that we need to consider in cross-section of the neck. And just before we finish, I want to just highlight an important space within the neck. Now, obviously on this image, we've got lots of space between the structures here, which in life wouldn't be the case. These would be much more sort of squashed together. But because we have got fascial compartmentalisation, there are potential spaces between the structures. And an important one I want to draw your attention to is here. And this is the retropharyngeal space. And the retropharyngeal space, as you can see, is between the buccopharyngeal fascia of the pretracheal fascia and the prevertebral fascial layer just here, and it's bounded laterally by the carotid sheath. So this space here is just an important deep space of the neck to make note of, because if infections or an abscess develops in this space, there is a potential passageway from within the neck right the way down into the mediastinum in the thorax. And that's because of the extent to which these fascial layers run the length of the neck. So while retropharyngeal infections or infections in the retropharyngeal space or abscesses are fortunately very rare, when they do happen, there is a big concern that they could spread into the mediastinum and cause a condition called mediastinitis, which has a very high mortality associated with it. Okay, so there's our cross-section of the neck. We've introduced the four deep cervical fascial layers and our single superficial cervical fascial layer, and just highlighted to you one of the important deep spaces of the neck. There are others, but I just want to draw your attention to this one in this video, and the risk of infections being able to spread from the neck down into the thorax and the mediastinum.